because life is a gift. After he had gotten up in years, singer and actor Frank Sinatra was asked what gift he wanted for his birthday. He replied, another birthday. We should thank God for every day, for breathing new life into us. Some mornings before I go to work, I go beyond just thanking the Lord for waking me up. But I thank him for allowing me to see a sunrise. Thank you for allowing me to hear the birds sing. Yes. Thank you for letting me feel your earth beneath my feet. It wasn't too long ago, I was late clocking into work because I was just enjoying the sunrise. It was beautiful. And it didn't matter that I was late for work because I didn't really want to be there anyway. Okay. I happened upon a quote that I thought was rather profound. It says, do not regret getting older because it is a privilege denied to many. Another reason not to regret getting older is the fact that if we are still alive, God has not finished his work in our lives, and he still has a work for us to do on earth. Besides growing older, it is indeed a privilege to be here with all of you this morning. At this time, we would like to welcome our visitors. I have one visitor card, and I believe the name is The names are Arletta and Walter Rue. Please forgive me if I mispronounce your name. At this time, City Temple, do what you do best and greet our new family members. Amen.
Won't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Won't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name.
Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile.
Jesus, you. Won't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Won't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name.
Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile.
Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Jesus, you. Won't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Won't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name.
Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile.
Jesus loves you. Won't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Won't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together
in Jesus' name.
Everybody
smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile. Everybody smile.
Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I'm so glad to be in God's house on this beautiful Sabbath morning. How about you? I love that song that says, greet somebody in Jesus' name. Tell them that you love them in Jesus' name. Everybody smile. See how many smiles we have out there this morning. Amen. Beautiful smiles. Jesus loves you. I want to welcome all of you, a special welcome to those who are visiting with us today. We're so glad to have you with us. I want to share a couple of brief announcements before we continue with our service today. We want to remind all of our ladies that today we have our Women's Ministry Book Club that's going on right after service today. Our Women's Ministry has just been having a wonderful time fellowshipping together, studying together, and ministering together. And if you're a woman, whether you attend regularly or not, we want to invite you to come and join the women downstairs right after the service today. Also, we want to remind everyone that Peterson Warren Academy is now open for registration for the 2019-2020 school year. Special dates for registration will be on August 8th, Sunday, August 8th, from 3 to 7 p.m. I'm sorry, that's not Sunday, is it? August 8th from 3 to 7 p.m., then Sunday, August 18th from 10 to 2. So August 8th from 3 to 7, then Sunday, August 18th from 10 to 2, and then the first day of school is going to be August 19th. Now, if you need alternate dates, either to register your students or to invite someone else to come to attend, we want to invite you to call the school and you'll be able to make alternate arrangements to register. The number is in your church bulletin this morning, as well as further details. Also, we want to remind all board members that board meeting is tomorrow at 10 a.m. We want to invite our board members to attend tomorrow for this important board meeting, and please plan to be on time. Also, our homecoming weekend, our annual homecoming weekend, we're excited. It's coming up the last weekend of this month, August 23rd to the 25th, starting off with a meet and greet at 6 o'clock on Friday the 23rd that will go till 6:45. Then we will have a Vesper program that will be put on by Dr. Kim Logan Nolan and the God Hands of Praise. And then on the next day, we're going to have Sabbath School attend and our Divine Hour with our guest choir being God's Echoes. And then we're going to have a wonderful meal together. Then at 5, we're going to have a God Echoes and Friends concert. And then on Sunday, we're going to be meeting in Southfield. Details are in your bulletin for our annual cookout. Amen. And so we want to invite you, first of all, to pray for this weekend. This is a time for us to be able to have fellowship together, to share in God's word with each other, to encourage each other in the Lord, and we're happy for that. But this is also an opportunity for us to invite those of us who we have not seen for some time to reach out to them and to invite them to come. Members of our community, family and friends, extended family, maybe relatives that you would like to invite to come. And so we want to use this as an opportunity not only to be blessed ourselves, but to be as a church family a blessing to others. So please plan to participate, start inviting, and also please start praying for this weekend that the Lord by His Spirit will use this to be a blessing for everyone and to forward the gospel work that He's doing here at City Temple. What do you say, everybody? May the Lord continue to bless us this morning as we worship Him in spirit and in truth.
Happy Sabbath. How's everybody doing today? I had a wonderful week. I'm just happy this morning, and I hope that what I share with you will just bring you closer to Christ and make you feel as good as I feel right now. Amen?
Take my heart and mold it. Amen. What do we long for? It's time for our tithe and offering. Just want to remind us that God expects us, after all the blessings He's given us, after all the love He's shown us, to show it to one another and to show it to Him. And through our tithe and offering, we can show that. We know that our tithe does not stay here at City Temple. We operate off of the offering, out of the love you show for God and this church. I was reading Malachi 1 last week, and this particular text struck me, at least part of the text struck me. And it said, a son honoreth his father, and a servant his master. If then I be a father, where is my honor? And if I be a master, where is my fear? Do we love the Lord today? I know times are hard for many of us, but what we often give for the Lord's sake comes back tenfold. There's no way we can pay for the Lord's blessings. So as the deacons come forward to lift this morning's tithe and offering, let's honor God today. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for everything you do for us and you keep doing for us. We thank you for allowing us to be a part of your church and a part of your kingdom. Father, we know that the cattle upon 1,000 hills are yours. And Father, you can do this work without us. But Father, help us to be a part of your work, that souls may be won to you. Father, we thank you for the opportunity, and we pray that you would bless this offering and bless those who give, those who have not to give. But that which we have left, Father, let it be able to cover all of our needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We serve. Almighty God we serve. Oh, angels bow before heaven and earth. No.
To the hands of those who have lost loved ones in the last 6 months. Let me see the hands of those who have sick loved ones, who are struggling with issues. I have sick loved ones who are struggling with issues. And we have a number of people on our sick list. And I think of Chase Brooks. His mom is here. And please remember to keep Chase Brooks in prayer, Miles Robinson, and a number of our people whose names are on the sick list. What I would like to do is for us to form groups right now, groups of four, two, three, four, and have a small testimony and have a small prayer, and I will end up with a closing prayer. So let's get started. Small group sessions.
Thank you.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Lord, we plead our request to you. You know the answer that's best for us. Give us hope and courage to press on so that things may happen for our benefit. Maybe not in this life, but in the life to come, where we will spend eternity with you, will there be no more sorrow, pain, sickness, or death. Until that time, O Lord, continue to abide with us. You have heard the prayers of our loved ones today. Lord, have mercy upon us and bless us, we pray, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, for grace to trust.
Amen.
Good morning. It's time for our children's story. So come on down, children, and everyone raise your dollar for Christian education. Happy Sabbath. It's so wonderful to see all these beautiful children's faces. They look so beautiful. Do you remember what God created on the fifth day of creation week? Do you remember? She said Adam and Eve. God's word says,
Genesis 1, verse 21. So God created great sea creatures and every living thing that moves, with which the waters abounded according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good.
He created great sea creatures. I have a few pictures of these great sea creatures. I want to see if you can recognize, if you recognize them. Do you know what this is? A dolphin, that's right, a dolphin. It's called a bottlenose dolphin. Why do you think it's called a bottlenose dolphin? The nose is like a bottle, that's right. And it helps them to swim faster and further in the water. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that great? How about this? Do you know what this is? That's right, a great hammerhead shark. Why do you think he's called a hammerhead shark? His head is like a big hammer. You see it? Like a big hammer. That's right. Is that amazing? Is that great? How about this fish? What do you think that is? A parrotfish. Why do you think he's called a parrotfish? He's got the colors of a parrot. That's right. Aren't those great? Beautiful? They are beautiful. You know, God created all these beautiful sea creatures, and he created you. You are wonderfully made. His word says,
Psalms 139, verse 13 and 14. For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Amen. You are beautifully and wonderfully and fearfully made. Can I get someone to pray today?
Father in heaven, thank you for this wonderful day. Thank you for everything you did for us. Thank you for driving us all to church safely, and thank you for bringing all our families here. Amen.
Amen. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for all your beautiful creations. We thank you for all the fish, all the beautiful colors that the fish have, and that we can continue to even marvel after their beauty and how you wonderfully made them. Thank you for making us so wonderful too. In Jesus' name, amen. You may go back to your seat.
Happy Sabbath. Today I will be reading 2 Kings chapter 7, verses 1 through 10. I will be reading in your hearing. Please stand. Verses 1 through 2. Then Elisha said, "Hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord, tomorrow about the time a sea of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel, and two seas of barley for so an officer on whose hand the king leaned," answered the man of God and said, "Look, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, could this thing be?" And he said, "In fact, you shall see it with your eyes, but you shall not eat of it." Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
a timeless theme. Earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new. That day, gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. Praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen
no.
in song. I can't wait till that day when there's no more night. How about you? Praises to great I am. I just received notice that there's an article in the current issue of the Lake Union Herald about academy students who are being commended for having a caring heart. And in this article, one of our students from Peterson and from right here at City Temple is included, Sister Shantanique Briggs. Amen. And so I want to recommend that you take a look at this article. After all, this is what our ministry in our home and in our church and our school is about, producing young people who have hearts for Jesus, caring hearts to be servants of God and for man. And we want to encourage Shantanique and all of our young people to do just that. What do you say, everyone? Amen. We're going to have a word of prayer and go right into the word at this time. If you'd bow your heads with me, Father, we ask in Jesus' name that you'd come close to us, that you would minister to us by your Spirit, that we would see Christ, and that we would give him our hearts, and that we would trust him for everything. In Jesus' name, let all God's children say, amen. And amen. I want to begin this morning by, or this afternoon, by sharing a story that I recently read. It was about a defendant who's on trial for murder. There was strong evidence indicating that he was guilty, but there was no body, no corpse. So in the defense's closing statement, the lawyer, knowing his client was probably going to be convicted, resorted to a trick. He got up and said, "Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I have a surprise for all of you," as he looked down at his watch. Within 1 minute, the presumed dead person, in this case, will walk into the courtroom. And at this, he looked toward the courtroom door. The jurors, somewhat stunned, all looked eagerly. A minute passed, and nothing happened. Finally, the lawyer said, "Actually, I made up the previous statement. But you all looked with anticipation. Therefore, I put it to you that you have a reasonable doubt in this case as to whether anyone was killed, and I insist that you return a verdict of not guilty." The jury, clearly confused, retired to deliberate. A few minutes later, however, they returned and pronounced a guilty verdict. "But how?" inquired the lawyer. "You must have had some doubt. I saw all of you staring at the door." The jury foreman replied, "Oh, yes, we looked, but your client didn't." The story teaches us an important lesson. At the end of the day, it's not so much our doubts as much as it is what we really believe that will determine the course of our destiny. Today, we're going to be looking at the role that belief plays in our spiritual lives and for our eternal future. We're using the title today, "This Time Tomorrow." I want to invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to our main scripture text, 2 Kings. And now I'm reading from 2 Kings chapter 6, beginning with verse 24, 2 Kings chapter 6, beginning with verse 24, and I'm reading from the English Standard Version for now, 2 Kings 26, chapter 6 rather, verse 24. It says, "Afterward, Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, mustered his entire army and went up and besieged Samaria. And there was a great famine in Samaria as they besieged it, until a donkey's head was sold for 80 shekels of silver, and a fourth part of a cob of dove's dung for 5 shekels of silver. Now as the king of Israel was passing by on the wall, a woman cried out to him, saying, 'Help, my lord, O king.' And he said, 'If the Lord will not help you, how shall I help you? From the threshing floor or from the winepress?' And the king asked her, 'What is your trouble?' She answered, 'This woman said to me, give your son that we may eat him today, and we will eat my son tomorrow. So we boiled my son and ate him. And on the next day I said to her, give your son that we may eat him. But she has hidden her son.' When the king heard the words of the woman, he tore his clothes. Now he was passing by on the wall, and the people looked, and behold, he had sackcloth beneath on his body. And he said, 'May God do so to me, and more also, if the head of Elisha, the son of Shaphat, remains on his shoulders today.' Elisha was sitting in his house, and the elders were sitting with him. Now the king had dispatched a man from his presence, but before the messenger arrived, Elisha said to the elders, 'Do you see how this murderer has sent to take off my head? Look, when the messenger comes, shut the door and hold the door fast against him. Is not the sound of his master's feet behind him?' And while he was still speaking with them, the messenger came down to him and said, 'This trouble is from the Lord. Why should I wait for the Lord any longer?'" It's hard times in the northern kingdom of Israel. The capital city, Samaria, is surrounded by their arch enemy, the Syrian army. No one can go out and no one can come in. The supply of food and other vital resources is cut off. The situation is so extreme that they have resorted to killing the stock animals, but not the sort that is usually or ordinarily eaten. A donkey's head is on sale for the exorbitant price of 80 shekels. That's 8 years' worth of wages for the average worker. A quart of dove's dung, that's right, bird waste, is going for 5 shekels. That's 6 months of salary. This is a living nightmare. The absolute worst case scenario. But it actually gets even worse. A gaunt, deranged woman cries out to the king as he passes by on the city wall. "My lord, the king," she says, "help me." But the king is not faring much better than she is. His note of bitterness is unmistakable as he retorts, "If the Lord can't help you, how can I? From the threshing floor or from the wine press, both places which usually produce food and drink are now barren and empty." The woman's story is a tale of horror. In desperation, hunger, and obviously a good dose of madness, she and another mother broker a deal. On one day, they would feast on her son, and the next day, they would devour her neighbor's son. Only once her son has been eaten, the other woman hid hers to save him from the same fate. the grisly tale is bad enough, but when we stop and consider it, we realize that the most disturbing detail is the distorted perception, the dead conscience of the woman. She is not troubled that she ate her son. Her angst is that her neighbor has unfairly withheld hers. This is the condition of Israel. They are lost and impaired in every possible way, physically, morally, socially, economically, spiritually. These are the tragic results of resisting God, His Word, His Spirit, and His representatives. The depravity that expresses itself as brutality in these heartless women manifests itself as cynicism in the heart of the king. His response has no hint of the wisdom of Solomon, who ruled in his day with the stamp of God's approval and blessing. Instead, he gives in to a growing sense of futility and frustration. He tears his clothes and promises to kill Elisha, the man of God. In other words, his anger and resentment is directed at God. Even though God had warned his people from the time of Moses that if they continually resisted his attempts to bring them back to him in faith and obedience, this would be the sure results. He predicted that they would even get so far as to eat their own children. And now it has happened. But how often do we forget the role that we play in bringing our own selves to hard and difficult places? How easy it is for us to blame God. The king is lamenting, actually, something that had just happened not long ago. It's recorded in the story right before this one in 2 Kings 6. It was a time when the Lord, through Elisha, had blinded a large part of the Syrian army and walked them right into Samaria. The king wanted to kill them. But Elisha said, no, don't kill them. He instructed that he feed them and send them home. So now that the same soldiers with many more like them have come back in larger numbers, he imagines that doing things God's way has set him up for his current trials. So he sends a messenger ahead of him to announce his displeasure and to take off Elisha's head. Meanwhile, Elisha is sitting in his house with the city elders, unruffled and undisturbed. His connection with God is so strong that he knows everything that's going to happen before it even takes place. He even knows that he's sending someone to kill him before the assassin arrives. When the messenger gets to the door, following Elisha's instructions, the men bar the door, waiting for the king to get there. But he's still able to get out the words that the king has sent him to say. This is the Lord's doing. Why should I wait on the Lord any longer? I wonder if there's anyone in the house today who's thinking the same thing. Following God's way is not working. Why should I wait for the Lord? Why should I hope in the Lord? Why should I trust in the Lord any longer? If he cared, he would have stopped the cancer. If he cared, he would have kept my loved one from dying. If he wanted to, he could have provided the financial resources
to get me out from under this load of debt. If he wanted to, I would finally have my baby. If he wanted to, I would finally see my marriage coming together. I would finally be able to find a mate. If he were real, surely by now, he would have answered my prayers. Our attitude, in acute, difficult, yea, even impossible situations, is a very good indicator of where our hearts are in reference to the heart of God. Let me ask you today, how do you respond when confronted by seemingly impossible situations? In Samaria, the unbelief is so deep that not even the word of God has any effect on the king and his cohorts. Look at how they respond. Now, 2 Kings chapter 7, beginning with verse 1. But Elisha said, no, the king just said, why should I wait on the Lord any longer? Here's Elisha's answer. But Elisha said, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord, tomorrow about this time, a seed of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel. That's about 7 liters. And 2 seeds, about 14 liters of barley, for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. Then the captain on whose hand the king leaned said to the man of God, if the Lord himself should make windows in heaven, could this thing be? Smart aleck. But he said, meaning Elijah, you shall see it with your own eyes, but you shall not eat of it. The cynicism is so thick that they are not comforted by the word of God. They're not encouraged by the promise of God for deliverance. In fact, hearing the word of God actually strengthens their unbelief. I can't help but think about some friends of ours who told us several years ago, when their son was about 4 years old, he was being homeschooled by his mom. And he was and still is a very intelligent little boy. But at 4 years old, his mom was home teaching him, and she's trying to teach him his math and how to read. And she said that one day he looked up to her with furrowed eyebrows. He said, Mommy, are you sure you know what you're doing? 4 years old. So often, we too, like this 4-year-old, are prone to exalt ourselves in doubt and unbelief. We murmur and complain. We're quick to turn to our own way, to our own devices. We're so easily gripped by a spirit of doubt and skepticism, when all the while God is trying over and over and over again to get across to us the message, you can trust me. You can trust me. And this is what he proves once again to unfaithful Israel. Look at what happens next. Now, chapter 7, beginning with verse 3. Now I've got to read a large section, because that's how it is with Old Testament stories. So let's read it together. Now there were 4 men who were lepers at the entrance of the gate, and they said to one another, why are we sitting here until we die? If we say, let us enter the city, the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we say, if we stay here, we die also. So now, come, let us go over to the camp of the Syrians. If they spare our lives, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall but die. So they arose at twilight to go into the camp of the Syrians. But when they came to the edge of the camp of the Syrians, behold, there was no one there. For the Lord had made the army of the Syrians hear the sound of chariots and of horses, the sound of a great army. So they said to one another, behold, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of Egypt to come against us. You remember earlier when Elisha was at Dothan and the Syrians surrounded the city, and the young lad, his servant, was afraid, and he praised the Lord, open his eyes. And when he opened his eyes, the young man was able to see all over the mountains, chariots of fire and horses of fire, the angels of the Lord and the Lord's host. Now that invisible army is what the Lord causes the Syrians to hear. And so they run off. So they fled away in the twilight and abandoned their tents, their horses, and their donkeys, leaving the camp as it was, and fled for their lives. And when these lepers came to the edge of the camp, they went into a tent and ate and drank, and they carried off silver and gold and clothing and went and hid them. Then they came back and entered another tent and carried off things from it and went and hid them. Then they said to one another, we are not doing right. This day is a day of good news. If we are silent and wait until the morning light, punishment will overtake us. Now, therefore, come, let us go and tell the king's household. So they came and called to the gatekeepers of the city and told them, we came to the camp of the Syrians, and behold, there was no one to be seen or heard there, nothing but the horses tied and the donkeys tied in the tents as they were. Then the gatekeepers called out, and it was told within the king's household. And the king rose in the night and said to his servants, listen to this dude, I tell you what the Syrians have done to us. They know that we are hungry. Therefore, they have gone out of the camp to hide themselves in the open country, thinking when they come out of the city, we shall take them alive and get into the city. He's a cynic to the end. And one of his servants said, servant, let some men take 5 of the remaining horses, seeing that those who are left here will fare like the whole multitude of Israel who have already perished. Let us send and see. So they took 2 horsemen, and the king sent them after the army of the Syrians, saying, go and see. So they went after them as far as the Jordan, and behold, all the way was littered with garments and equipment the Syrians had thrown away in their haste, and the messengers returned and told the king. Then the people went out and plundered the camp of the Syrians. So a sea of fine flour was sold for a shekel, and 2 seas of barley for a shekel, according to the word of the Lord. Now the king had appointed the captain on whose hand he leaned to have charge of the gate, and the people trampled him in the gate, so that he died as the son of God, the man of God, rather, had said when the king came down to him. For when the man of God had said to the king, 2 seas of barley shall be sold for a shekel, and a sea of fine flour for a shekel, about this time tomorrow in the gate of Samaria, the captain had answered the man of God, if the Lord himself should make windows in heaven, could such a thing be? And he had said, you shall see it with your own eyes, but you shall not eat of it. And so it happened to him, for the people trampled him in the gate, and he died. God's solution tends to come in the most unexpected way. Ellen White says in Ministry of Healing, excerpts from pages 480 to 482, she says, our Heavenly Father has 1,000 ways to provide for us of which we know nothing. Those who accept the one principle of making the service of God supreme will find perplexities vanish and a plain path before their feet. In the darkest days, when appearances seem most forbidding, have faith in God. He is working out his will doing all things well on behalf of his people. The strength of those who love and serve him will be renewed day by day. Who could have guessed what would have happened that same night? The lepers have nothing to lose. They are social outcasts. They are walking dead men. They reason that while facing death on every side, their best alternative is to fall on the mercy of the Syrians. Yet to their surprise, they stumble upon the booty of war. They go looking for mercy, yet unexpectedly, they are given victory. When they return with the good news, once again, the king will not believe. His servants have to convince him to send out a small team of scouts. Only then do they perceive the miracle. In less than 24 hours, God has turned an impossible situation completely around. From emptiness to overflowing bounty, from a donkey's head for 80 shekels to 7 liters of premium flour for 1 shekel in less than 24 hours. When they return, the lesson rather, it for us is not to focus on the time period, but for us to focus on God and his ability to turn everything around. The time period is meant to show us his power over impossible situations. In other words, if he could do this in 24 hours, what can't he do? Is anything too hard for the Lord? The emphasis of this story is his ability, his watch care, his love. The story is meant to teach us that we can trust him. Even when his answer does not come immediately, he will save, he will deliver. Ultimately, we can trust him. He may not come when you want him, but he'll be there right on time. Somebody said, he's an on-time God. Oh, yes, he is. What impossible situation are you facing right now? Whatever it may be, this time tomorrow, he has the power to turn things around. Whatever it may be, this time tomorrow, he is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ask or think or even imagine. This time tomorrow, he is able to make a way out of no way. This time tomorrow, only trust him. Somebody's saying, but what if it's not tomorrow? Yet I hear the prayer of Moses when he cries out, Lord, satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. What morning is Moses referring to? Well, on one level, he's including tomorrow morning. But on the deepest level, he's talking about that great getting up morning. Whether it's tomorrow morning or the great getting up morning, either way, only trust him. My brother, my sister, trust in God. Don't give up on his promised deliverance. Don't stop hoping in his salvation. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is a good thing to quietly hope and wait on the salvation of the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Wait on the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Hope in the Lord. And don't stop this time. Tomorrow. The story is also meant to point out the unbelief and therefore the impotence of the king. In the Old Testament, a key feature of the office of king in Israel is for him to be a helper, a deliverer, a savior. He's supposed to be able to do all these things because he's the anointed of God. He should have the power of God to deliver, to help, and to save. Being able to demonstrate this in his anointing was meant to be the way that he brought credibility and validity to the fact that he was king. The king demonstrated the presence and power of Yahweh's anointing by military victory and protecting the people from their enemy, and by wisdom to administer justice through righteous judgments. For instance, back in 2 Kings chapter 10, verse 27, right after Saul, the first king, is anointed, there's some rebels who want to invalidate his anointing and his claim to kingship. So they ask the question, how can this man save us? How can he save us? The word for save is the same word that's used by the distressed woman when she calls out to the king for help. Literally, she says, my lord, the king, save me. In the case of Saul, right after these men ask that question, the very next story is Saul riding out with his army and delivering the people of Jabesh-Gilead from their enemies, therefore showing that the Spirit of Yahweh was with him and he established his kingship and his kingdom. But in this story, the king proves his illegitimacy as Yahweh's representative because he is a king who cannot save. But it is his unbelief, his persistent rejection of Yahweh's word and spirit and prophet that disqualifies him. Do we realize that unbelief in God's word disqualifies us in whatever position we hold because it makes us powerless and ineffective? Think about that for just a moment. Wherever you are, unbelief in God and his word makes you ineffective and powerless in the charge that you have. Because of the king's persistent unbelief, because of his pride and self-sufficiency, because of his resistance to the Spirit of God, God takes salvation out of his hands and puts it in the hands of lowly lepers. He uses the despised things, the outcast things, the weak things to bring about his seemingly impossible and unlikely salvation to demonstrate his power and his glory. He uses the weak things. It is interesting how 2 Kings records another king. Not a wicked king from Israel, but a faithful king in Judah, King Hezekiah. In chapter 18, he too faces a seemingly impossible situation. The world superpower at that time, the nation, the kingdom, the empire of Assyria, which has already by now decimated the northern kingdom of Israel, comes against him and his major cities, including Jerusalem. The Syrians have him completely surrounded, and they resort to tactics of intimidation and ridicule to shame him before they crush him. The Syrian king sends him a threatening letter to assure him that unless he surrenders, his defeat is certain. But look at how Hezekiah responds. Now I'm looking at 2 Kings chapter 19, verses 14 to 19. Look at how Hezekiah responds. And Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. Then Hezekiah prayed before the Lord and said, O Lord God of Israel, the one who dwells between the cherubim, you are God. You alone of all the kingdoms of the earth have made heaven and earth. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. And hear the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to reproach the living God. Truly, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste the nations and their lands and have cast their gods into the fire, for they were not gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore, they destroy them. Now, therefore, O Lord, our God, I pray, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you are the Lord God, you alone. Look at how a godly king responds to a crisis. He does not turn away from God in despondency. He turns towards God in dependence. He does not threaten the man of God, but instead, God sends his promised deliverance through the prophet Isaiah. And you know the end of the story. In one night, one angel goes into the Assyrian camp. And in the morning, the very next morning, 185,000 Assyrian soldiers are all dead men. The very next morning. Soon after that, the Assyrian king is killed by two of his sons. Assyrian problem solved. This is the type of confidence that we are called to have in God, especially through his anointed one, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, our Savior, God's Messiah, Jesus Christ. He is the great King to whom every other king points. This is why Isaiah says of him, there shall come forth from the rod, a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the young goat, the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. That's what our King Jesus is going to do. That's why our faith is in him. We can trust Jesus. Do you trust God in Christ? in desperate, hopeless, and impossible situations? Or are you a scoffer, a skeptic, a cynic? His deliverance may seem unlikely, especially right now. But it is coming. Those who believe in him will enjoy it. But those who refuse to believe will see it with their eyes and have none. For those who believe, that day will be a day of doom. For those who don't believe, but for those who believe, it will be a day of rejoicing and salvation. Who believes the word of God today? I read about an F-15 fighter jet pilot who flew in Desert Storm in Iraq. He was leading actually a team of planes that were coming to bomb the opening night of bombing for the war. And as he was flying, because they wanted to diminish the possibility for the enemy to detect them, they were flying completely dark. And they chose a moonless night so that they would have the advantage. And so there they were, flying in the darkness. They had no way of seeing to be able to orient themselves. They had to trust and rely on the instruments in the plane, in the cockpit. That's all they had. There he was leading, going to bomb a chemical plant, when it just so happened that someone on the ground locked onto him with a surface-to-air missile. And so he had to fly and maneuver in order to break the lock that they had on him. And he was successful. But in doing all of the maneuvers that he did, by the time he was finished and had broken the lock, he was completely disoriented. His equilibrium was gone and he was dizzy. He didn't know what was top, up, or what was down. As a matter of fact, he was sure that he was in a climbing right turn upward. But his instruments were telling him that he was diving towards the ground at 60 degrees. So the instruments were saying, pull up. But everything in his head and heart was telling him, I need to adjust by diving down. And he wondered what he should do. And finally, he decided, split moment, to just do what the instrument said. So even though it went completely against everything he thought, instead of diving down, he pulled up sharply. Right after that, he saw that his altitude was above the Rocky Mountains. In 3 more seconds, he would have crashed right into the mountains. Beloved, we're living in a time in Earth's history where we're flying in the dark. Darkness is all around us. And if we think that we're going to be able to navigate based on our own intelligence and our own feelings, then we're deceived. What we need more than ever right now is to trust the instruments that God has given us. He's given us his word. He's given us his spirit, the inner witness of the spirit with the word. He's given us the ability to draw near to Christ. So like Elisha, we'll be able to know what's going on and what's happening and what he wants us to do. He's given us his representatives to share his word and to teach his word. Woe be unto us if we reject all of that to say, I'm going to do things my way. I'm going to follow my gut. I'm going to go with my feeling. I'm just going to follow the crowd and the trend and what's popular. The sure result is destruction. Now more than ever, we need to trust in the Lord with all our hearts and lean not unto our own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. I don't know about you today, but I'm determined to trust Jesus. I'm going to trust Jesus. Is your desire just to affirm today, just to affirm, I want to trust Jesus. I want to draw near to him. I want to be able to know his voice and to be led by his spirit and his word. That's what I want. That's what I want to walk in. If that's you, I just want to invite you to stand as I prepare to pray. In a life of trust in Jesus. Even as you stand, my second appeal, so the person who may realize that for whatever reason you've been finding it hard to trust him. Maybe you have been facing some impossible seeming situation, some difficulty, something that seems hopeless. Maybe you've been praying and it seems as though the Lord's deliverance and help is not coming. Maybe, just maybe, you've even started to become discouraged. Maybe you've doubted God. Maybe even there's someone among us who has started to give in to feelings of bitterness and cynicism. But today you hear the Spirit of Christ speaking to your heart and saying, you can trust me. No matter what the trial, no matter what the test, no matter what the odds are, you can trust me. Don't look at how things appear, but listen to my word. Listen to my voice. Take heed to my promises. Let me show you my son, my king, my deliverer, your savior. You can trust me. And today you want to take him at his word. Today you want to say, Lord, I can't see. I don't know how you can deliver. I don't know where it will come from. But Lord, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you. If that's you, I want to pray a special prayer for you. Won't you step out of your pew and come? Lord, I'm going to trust you. I don't know how, but I'm going to trust you today, Lord. I hear you calling me to trust you. And by your grace, I will trust you. If that's you, just come on down. Only you and Jesus know exactly what's going on. But you're determined today. You're determined to trust him. Won't you come? Let me pray for you. Let me pray for you. I see the hands of those just raising your hands. They can't come right now, but you're raising your hand. Praise God. I'm going to trust him. Praise God. I see those hands. I see those hands. He's working. He's working just to reveal over and over again. You can trust me. I don't know about you, but in my life, in our family's life, over and over, he's revealing. You can trust me. You can. And it seems like just as soon as he teaches one lesson, the very next trial comes and we forget. And he shows us again, you can trust me. You can trust me. He's a good God. He's a loving God. He's an on-time God. You may not see his deliverance right now, but he hears and he loves and he cares and he will deliver. If not immediately, ultimately he will deliver. And you can trust him. We can trust him. Finally today, my final appeal is for the person under the sound of my voice who hears Jesus speaking to your heart and saying, you need to give your heart completely to me now. Stop being the king or the queen in your life and come under the kingship of my son. You need to give yourself to me completely. Not with eye service, not just in appearances, not just with words, but to give me your whole self. Put your life in my hands. Put your business in my hands. Put your family in my hands. You need to trust me now completely. You need to give yourself to me and become mine. Become mine totally and completely. You hear the call of Christ by his Spirit saying that to your heart, and you want to say, yes, Lord. I don't know how, Lord, but yes. That's you. Just raise your hand. You want to answer his call? Amen. You want to give your life and your heart to him completely. You want to say, King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine may the glory be. And make him the King and Savior of your life. I see those hands. Oh, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word today. Lord, we thank you for your lessons that keep coming in waves, in which you keep on saying to us, quietly, yet persistently, you can trust me. Only trust me. I will deliver. I will heal. I will make whole. I will save. Only trust me. Turn away from your unbelief. Stop your doubting. Give up your skepticism. Maybe even your cynicism, and trust me. Oh, thank you for that word. Thank you for your son, Jesus, who gave all that in him we may have all. Now, Lord, oh God, we ask that you would take away every sense of pride, every bit of self-sufficiency. Lord, take away the attitude of the king. Lord, take away the attitude of the captain that says, how can this be? How can God do this? Lord, take away our sense of pragmatism and reason and what makes sense and our reliance on our intelligence and our intellect and our know-how and our wit. Lord, may that lie smitten in the dust and may we turn to Jesus. Say, Jesus, oh Lord, the King, save me. Save me, oh God. And we know, oh God, that you will save. Lord, not only for those who are standing, but for those especially who've come down. You know the exact challenges that they're facing right now. Lord, you know. You know the seemingly impossible situation. It seems like it can never turn around. Lord, they've been waiting. They've been praying. It seems as though the answer has not been coming. And Lord, the enemy has been whispering to them discouragement and doubt and despondency. But Lord, today I pray that you would upend every one of his lies, dismantle them, oh God, and expose him as the liar and the accuser that he is. And Lord, turn their eyes to your son, Jesus, their deliverer, their only hope, and their savior. And Lord, today by faith, may they reach out and say, yes, Lord, I trust you. And finally, oh Lord, for those who raise their hands, because they want to give their hearts to you for real this time, wholeheartedly. Lord, I'm asking, oh God, that you would take their lives and make them fully yours. Perform the miracle in their hearts that you've promised. Renew them by your Spirit. Lord, send them into your word. Give them a hunger and an appetite for the word of God and for the company of the people of God, that they may be strengthened and encouraged. Lord, anoint them with your Spirit. Convert them and make them yours. Take every part of their lives and bring it under subjection to their Lord, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. And finally, Lord, we ask that you navigate us through this dark time in this earth's history right before you come. Lord, we don't know up from down right now, but we trust you. In Jesus' name, let all God's children say, amen. Amen. God bless you. Won't you greet somebody? Won't you greet somebody? In the name of Jesus.
trust him now.
May we stand for the benediction.
It is with unspeakable gratitude, O Father, and we have not the words to say to thank you for being our God, for loving us and caring for us. Father, we pray that you would give us the faith to trust you, because ultimately you want to save us all in your kingdom. So just help us to trust that this is your will and that you will do this. And now fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. To the Almighty, in Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.